Hey, good evening, everybody. Hi, this is Colin Go here, and I have with me Colin Yee. Yeah. Hey, hi. So, welcome to the third episode of the Property Market Analysis Show with Colin and Colin. I think for today, we will have a wonderful segment because we are talking about something that is on a lot of property investors' mind. Yeah, so I'll let Colin he talk about that in a little while, but maybe let me just share a bit about why we are doing this show and what really happened last week. So, you know, I think Colin and I, a couple of weeks ago, we sat down and then, I mean, in our own homes, and then we had a chat to talk about, you know, the various type of, you know, sentiments out there. Especially during this COVID-19 pandemic, some people are saying that, hey, you know, the market is going to go really south, you know, but some people say that there's a good opportunity to maybe find some good deals during this pandemic. Well, we've spoken to Colin Yee, you know, for 2 weeks already, and you have known his take on this. But today we go a little bit more specific into answering one question that a lot of you have, which is how do you find a property that is undervalued by up to $300,000? $300,000, mind you, not $3,000, not $30,000, $300,000 during this circuit breaker period. Now, Colin, you know, the floor is all yours, please.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much, Colin Go, and good evening, everyone. I see that a few friends I know. Thanks, Calvin Lim, Lau Pei Ling, May, client Maxi, John Lim, for coming tonight for this sharing session, right? So, I think the COVID-19 pandemic has been around for some time, and last week I spoke about whether the pandemic is positive news or negative news for the property market. And the answer to that question actually very much depends on what you are looking to do, right? And I think for most people, they are looking to buy properties which are of better value, right? So obviously they hope that with the pandemic, the prices of properties will go down in the next few months, right? So the thing is that last week I addressed this question about, you know, whether how likely is the price going to go down for this year in terms of property market, right? And I have shared that the outcome is not very likely, right? Prices will drop a lot, right? If you want to specifically know the reason, the detailed explanations has been I've spoken about them in the last video, right? If you want to check, just have a look, you can just go back to last week's video and just scroll down, and that is a 1 hour section, right, where Colin Go gave me an interview and I explained why for this year the property prices are unlikely to go down, right? But for the benefit of everybody here who have been maybe not with us last week, I will just quickly recap some of those reasons, right? So just let me exit this thing and do a share screen, and you can see some of the slides that I've prepared, right? Just let me try to do this. Colin Go, can you let me share my screen, please?
Okay.
Because yes. I can't do it on my end.
Okay, you should be able to share your screen now.
Be able to, okay. Mm. Just let me see where are my slides. Okay. Right, there you go. So just to check with you, Colin Go, can you see something on your screen now?
Yes.
You can see, Right, okay, good. So actually, since this pandemic, I think we, myself and Colin Go is my good friend, right? He is not a property agent, he's not in the property space, but he's a property investor, and his profession is more towards marketing in general, right? Digital or traditional or social media kind of marketing. So I've known him for almost like four or five years already, and we thought that, you know, during this lockdown period, maybe we can do some sharing with people like yourself or, you know, interested in properties and about certain topics which a lot of people are curious or want to know, right? So this is actually the third week we are doing this. Next week will be another one. So in June, maybe we'll schedule more on certain topics which most people are interested in. So for this tonight, the topic is really where to find properties that are undervalued by 300,000 during the circuit breaker period, right? And this thing may extend beyond the circuit breaker. As you know, the government has already announced yesterday that 1st of June, certain measures is going to be lifted. In fact, the whole circuit breaker is going to be ended, right? It's just that we are opening up in phases, right? So the thing is that undervalued properties is always something which is very attractive and will always be around. The question is whether you are able to find them or not, right? So 300,000, this is not a number which I plug in the air. It is really possible today, if you look around, there will be properties that may give you that kind of, you know, a potential, right? Okay, or being undervalued by, you know, 200,000, 300,000. The question is, as I will explain later in this video, how do you go about explaining this, right? Okay, so the thing is, let's begin, right? So the next thing is, last week I shared about today, if let's say you're a property investor or property buyer, there are only two sources out there that you can purchase a property, right? So either from the resale market or from a developer. So let's look at the resale market first, right? So if let's say you are intending to buy a property from a resale market, that means that you are buying from an existing seller of the property, right? So the question is, how likely will you be able to buy an undervalued property from a seller, okay? And this is following from last week, my explanation, just to recap very quickly, right? Before I show you this, I think just to tell you the answer first, right? Just tell you the answer, right? Is that for this year, it is quite unlikely that you will be able to get a good deal from an existing seller, right? Okay. Why do I say that? There are actually five reasons here, okay? So I'll quickly go through, right? So if we look at the property market in general for the whole of Singapore, since today is 2020, right? So there are so many cooling measures that we have implemented. Our government has implemented over the years, right? So if I take a cutoff point, in the year 2013, right, before 2013 and after 2013. So for property owners who have bought a property before 2013, right, chances are they would have paid down a bit of their loan plus their properties would have appreciated, right, till today. So meaning that they are sitting on good capital gains and their loan is much lower, right? So the question is, why would these people want to, in this time, right, even with COVID, why would they want to sell their property at a low price? Because there's a lot of equity, right, in their properties, right? So that's really for those people who have bought before 2013. Now, what about those people who bought after 2013, right? Okay, maybe I just explain why I like to use the year 2013. If you recall, 2013 was the year that government came up with the total debt servicing ratio, okay, June 2013, and that really stopped the overheated market. Otherwise, from 2009 until 2012, the market was like going up, and nothing can stop the market, even with the ABSD, right? So 2013 June, when government restrict the loan that y'all can take, property buyers can take, it really stopped, right? The prices from running away. So 2013 until today, I like to use this period because this is what I call a stabilized environment where prices are gradually moderating, right? It's not going up a lot, it's not going down a lot, right? So for people who have bought a property after 2013, right, chances are they would have also paid down a bit in terms of their loan, right? And their properties may or may not have appreciated that much, right? But the thing is that they bought their properties in an environment where all the existing cooling measures are in place, right? Especially the total debt servicing ratio, which ensures that property buyers today are not over-leveraged, right? So meaning to say that these people, or most people, property owners today, have the holding power, right? In terms of holding on to their properties, and they don't need to sell off at a cheap price. Okay, that's the first reason. Second reason is that I'm sure you are aware that April this year, the government passed through this COVID-19 temporary measures bill in the, you know, and as part of the measures to help a lot of people, right? So one of them is actually the MAS property loan relief. So as long as you are a property owner, right, whether you are a commercial, industrial, or residential property owner, as long as you own a property in Singapore, okay, you can go to your bank and say that, sorry, I lost my job, I have a pay cut, can you defer my loan, right? So you don't need to pay a single cent to the bank from now until all the way to December. Okay, you can simply defer your loan, right? So what is the implication of this, right? Now, you see, for a seller to fire sale their property to you at a cheap price, at a discount, so they can buy at undervalued, right? It really means that the seller is desperate or distressed, right? So with this MES property loan relief, it solved their distress problem because the banks are no longer are coming after them, at least for this year, right? So this year, the banks are not coming after me. So why should I sell my properties now? Because I got relief, you see, right? I got this relief thing that I can tap on too. I don't need to sell my properties at a huge discount, right? So this is the second reason, at least for this year. Now, the third reason is, if you look at the MES financial report, right, the significance is that since for the last maybe 10 years, right, over the last 10 years, our savings and our fixed deposits in the financial institutions have been going up every year, right? So what does this mean? This means people have put more money in their savings account with the banks, right? And also it means that actually there's a lot of spare ammunition, right, that they have. If they want to buy a second property, they can actually afford. They want to pay the ABSD, actually people can still afford, right? And if let's say there's a distress, they also need not sell. They can use part of the money to pay the banks, right? So from the financial report, actually we can see that most people, right, most generally, I think property owners, it's safe to say that they have some reserve that they don't need to really go and fire sale their properties, right? Okay. Now, fourth reason, auction sale. I've explained this last week. If you look at the auction numbers in the last 8 years, right, every year there have been more properties put up for sale through auction, right? And let's say 2019, last year, there were about 1,500 units, right, being put through auction for sale. Okay, now the numbers is one thing, but we also have to look at the success rate of how many of properties are actually really sold through the auction, and the success rate has been very low. Right. Traditionally, it has been about 5%, right? And last year was actually even worse. Last year was only 1.4%. So meaning to say that for every 1,000 properties that were put through to sell through an auction, only 14 were sold last year. For example, let's use 1,000 properties as an example, right? So if you think about it logically, a lot of people think that, oh, I go auction, I can buy, you know, cheap properties and you know, get good deal from there. That is the thinking of a lot of people, right? Now, many of these people are going to be, you know, disappointed and walk away, you know, feeling disappointed. It's really because the mindset is not there, right? That they think that they go to an auction, they can buy cheap properties at lay long prices. It's not going to happen, okay? The numbers already tell you, right? 1.4% last year. If properties sold through an auction are really such good deals, right? Then everybody should just go and chiong and go and buy properties from auction already,
exactly,
right?
Yeah.
But the thing is, why is it not happening? Why is the success rate only 1.4%, not like 80%, 90%? So that tells you one thing, that properties sold through auction, actually they have a reserve price, right? This is to protect the price integrity of the property market in general. It cannot be if today you own a condo, $1 million, okay? Your neighbor under, you know, mortgagee sale, the bank come and do a foreclosure, and then the bank will anyhow sell at $700,000, right? Then what's going to happen to your property price? Suddenly drop to $700,000, right? Government will not allow this kind of thing to happen, never, right? So that's why even those like Knight Frank, CBRE, Savills, or, you know, all these, you know, auction companies, they have a reserve price. Maybe $3 million, they can give you, okay, discount 2.8, that's all. But people go in and think 2.8 is not good enough for me, I want 2.2. It's not going to happen, right? So the thing is, auction sale also tell you that it's extremely hard, even in an auction, through an auction, to buy undervalued properties, right? Seriously deep discount properties. Now, the last reason is that I'm sure most of you are aware, right, that today we have so many cooling measures that makes, you know, property investing quite challenging, right? But at least I'm glad that I'm seeing 60 people here actually, right, tonight. Right? Thank you very much, everyone, for joining, right? The thing is that we have so many cooling measures tonight. If the property prices is really going to go down, right, because of COVID or because of whatever reasons, right, the good thing is that government can simply remove or tweak a few cooling measures to support the prices, right? And the first one they are going to target, I can tell you, is the additional buyer stamp duty. That's for sure. I think that's what you want also, right? It's because really there's a lot of we talk about HDB owners, HDB owners, right? Today HDB owners are very challenging, right? Because a lot of them have the aspiration to buy a second property, a condo, right? And they may not want to sell their HDB, but they don't sell, they don't have money to buy the condo, right? So the thing is they have no choice, they have to sell. So if you remove this ABSD thing, right, okay, firstly they don't need to pay an ABSD, it will be a big attraction for them. They'll keep their HDB, and all of them, a lot of them will go and buy a second property already, right? So the thing is, what's the implication? Right? Locals are going to come back to buy properties. Even foreigners, if you lower the ABSD, they will also come in, a lot of them, right? Because Singapore is known for a safe haven for investment, right? So what is the implication of all this is that prices of properties are going to be supported again, right? So with all these five reasons that you see on the slide here, right? If you are still thinking of, you know, buying a property cheaply from a seller in the resale market, I think it is quite unlikely to happen, right? And is, I would say, it is quite not very possible, not very likely that you will be able to encounter this kind of situation, right? Sellers do not need to sell you cheap their properties because of all these reasons that I've listed down here, okay? So, okay, I will continue on to the next portion, which is, if today you are, based on these reasons I've shared with you, you are unlikely to find something of, you know, of good value or undervalued properties from the resale market, right, okay? Then where else should you look, right? Then the other source, right? The other source will be from the developers, right? Okay, before I go to developers, I just want to show you one thing, right? Show you one thing. This is a screenshot from Property Guru, right? Property Guru. You can see the little red box over here, okay? Little red box over here. That the number is about 68,000. So what is the number here talking about? So basically, there are 68,000 residential listings on Property Guru. And as you know, Property Guru is one of the largest, you know, one of the most well-known property portal like in Singapore, if you want to buy property. So most people will know what Property Guru is. So there are 68,000 residential properties listed on Property Guru, right? Now the challenge is, if today, let's say you want to buy a resale property from the resale market, right? Obviously, this is one of the places you will definitely come and look for properties, right? And is it possible, you ask yourself, is it possible for you to look through each and every one, 68,000 listings here? I don't think it's possible, right? Even 680 listings, I think your eyes will go blind already. And not forgetting, actually, there's a lot of junk listing, rubbish listing, duplicate listings inside here, right? You call the agent say no more, so or whatever, the price is something else, right? I've encountered so many of these kind of situations, right? So it makes it confusing for you as a seller or investor to go into Property Guru and try to look for undervalued properties. But the good news is, I have a software, right, that can help me trawl through all these 68,000 listings in Property Guru, right? And what it does is actually compare the valuation of that property based on certain algorithm with the valuation here. So if let's say you look at the first listing, right, 458,000, this HDB or this property, 458,000, right? So if my system says that this property based on valuation should be worth 600,000, this property here, 600,000, then it will show me a negative 140,000 negative, right? So the system allows me to zoom in on those large negative numbers. So those minus like 300,000, 400,000, 500,000, I can zoom in on those. And I can tell you, this is to help system technology to help me find undervalued properties from the resale market. Because it's sometimes this is what you want, right? So the thing is that even with technology, it will assist me to find undervalued properties. I can tell you one thing. I give you one very real example. Sometimes I see a big number. Wow, minus 500,000 means below market value 500,000, you know, listed on Property Guru. So what happens? I go and zoom in and go and find a listing, right, in Property Guru. I go and find, look for the one, right? And I realize there's actually one problem, what's the problem? The problem is that this property got some issue. Got some issue. What issue? You know what issue? Right. It's not a normal property. Right. This property is either a top floor unit or ground floor unit. Right. As you know, top floor unit, sometimes they're double volume. That means they actually airspace. Airspace means the strata area becomes bigger. Right. Or ground floor, because of the PS or the patio, the whatever garden outside, right? The area becomes bigger, but all these are not livable space, right? So the system is not smart enough to differentiate, oh, this is the highest floor unit, oh, this is a ground floor unit, right? They still think that, oh, this area is very big. Multiply by the PSF, give you $3 million, right? But this guy listing up down here only show you $2.5 million. Oh, wow, undervalued, $500,000, minus $500,000, show me, right? I go in and see, this kind of property, not $3 million. Actually, the listing price is accurate, is correct. I check the past record, it's correct. This is the result I'm telling you. So 68,000 listing, then if you want to find an undervalued property from a reseller, I can tell you, very challenging, right? Even if there are, and there will be, right? Trust me, there will be, because there will always be people who are selling properties and they may be able to let go at a lower price, right? There will be such people who are willing to sell at a lower price. But the question is, even if there are, will we come to you, right? Will we come to you, right? Chances are, it will have been bought by, if it's really such a good deal, like $1 million property, they sell for $800,000. I think maybe somebody else bought it already. Or maybe even the agent went by himself or herself, right? It will not come to you, right? So what I'm trying to say is, it is very difficult to find resale, good resale properties from the cheap resale properties from the resale market, right?
Okay, but Colin, sorry, Colin. Okay, yeah, let me just interrupt you for a bit down here. I think you'll be sharing, you know, gems down here that a lot of people hasn't really heard of before, you know, using technology to be able to trawl through, you know, 68,000 listings to get you the ones that you should watch out for, you know. But you know, maybe let us just take this opportunity to welcome all the new, you know, people who come on to watch this live. So you know, we have over at my side down here, I'm seeing Jeremy, Joseph, Lei Suan, Janine, Weiping, wow, so many more, Bruce, Gina, Wing Fai, you know, thank you so much. We have 60 over people watching at the same time right now, which is, I think, testament to, you know, what they really want to find out today. And so today, you know, in this third episode of the property market analysis, we are really talking about how can we find that undervalued property, not by $3,000, not by $30,000, but by $300,000. So you have heard, you know, Colin mentioned about the way that, you know, potentially this undervalued value can go wrong because, you know, maybe technology, that software that he's using is not smart enough. So what happens is you perhaps, you know, should rely on a human to give you that kind of analysis. Well, Colin E will talk about this a little bit more later. But I think I also want to take this opportunity to acknowledge what Colin E is doing down here, to be honest with you. You know, there's a reason why over 60 people are tuning in at the same time right now. I know Colin E for a few years now. You know, I worked with many property agents before, and Colin E has a license, a property agent license. But I know him that he's not someone who is like, you know, a normal property agent, where what happens if we do a show like this, okay, probably you'll be seeing slides after slides after slides of new launches. What's so good about a new launch? But today, he's not doing that. So he's showing you charts, he's showing you tables, he's showing you newspaper clippings, he's showing you facts and figures today. And so what is happening down here is he's not pitching. And you know, Colin E, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, down here you're just helping people to analyze what is right, what is wrong. And I guess, you know, going forward, we are seeing more of your slides right now. Colin can be sharing a lot of information, I tell you today. You know, we might hit, you know, 1 hour again. But you need to continue to stay with us to watch this show throughout to really get what Colin E is sharing. Now, for all of you, who are on our Facebook Live right now, either on PSF, Real Estate Academy, or Learns Marketing, if you have a question for Colin on undervalued property, now is a chance for you to type in the comments. Maybe if we have a little bit of time later, we can address some of them. Okay, last thing, Colin, you know, before I hand it over to you, sorry for interrupting you, is I put up a poll to ask all the audience down here, do you think that it's possible to find undervalued properties during this COVID-19 period? Now, surprisingly, surprise, surprise, okay, 22 of us, or you know, more than 70% actually said there's a good chance. But some, you know, are saying that not possible, you know, sellers won't go into a buyer sale. Now, there is truth to both answers. And what Colin E will be sharing with you reveals that both answers are actually right and they are actually wrong at the same time. Okay, so stay tuned with us and continue to watch. Ask your questions below, all right? Okay, Colin E, okay. Please continue.
And thanks very much, Colin Goh. So I'm looking at my screen right now. I see Jason Kamwe, a lot of my students, Mahendra, Fairuzi, Yap Kim San, Tan Li Si, Muhammad, Naha, oh, yeah, Jamie Lai, JC, even my brother, right, Max, Mr. Quek Tung Yang, long time no see, right, Ong Wei Ka, Ernest, my Everest teammate, Mr. Yong Pao King, Desmond Kwok, David, Raymond, John, Maxi, okay, all these I mentioned before. So thanks for coming tonight, right? So let me just continue, right? Otherwise, I'll overrun by a bit again, right? Last week, I did 1 hour. I think it was quite a bit too long. So I tried to moderate my time because I really have a lot of information I can share with people, right? Even on a phone call, sometimes I can talk for 45 minutes, right? But I try to give you whatever is the most important thing over here, right? So if you look at this screen here, actually, this resale property, I think, is quite a good example that one of my participants in my program, right, recently actually went out to the resale market and managed to buy this property, right, at is at Botanic and Bartley, 2-bedroom, dual key at about below $1 million, right? So you can see from the past transaction, based on this kind of size, right, it should be between about 1.05 to 1.1 million, right? So he managed to secure it below 1 million, which I think is pretty good deal, right? So easily about 50 to 100K of the transacted price, which I think is quite remarkable, right? But you don't normally see these kind of examples every day, right? It's really not easy to find, right? I know a lot of times, you know, sellers or other, you know, property agents try to market their property, will tell you, you know, undervalued, fire sale and all these things. But how do you determine whether the property is really, you know, undervalued or fire sale? I will not really go into it today because that can be another sharing by itself, right? I will probably explain this. How do you analyze this in a separate, you know, separate video, right? So anyway, this is just to show you that there are such properties possible in the resale market, just like what one of my, you know, students have done, right? But I would say it is quite challenging to be able to find such properties, right? Now, going to the developers, if the resale market, you are unlikely to be able to find something which is, you know, of fire sale or, you know, seriously, you know, deep discount, undervalued properties, then what about if you go to a developer, right? That means to say you buy a new project. Is it easy for you to buy so-called an undervalued property, right? Now, the thing is, again, you must understand how developers think and how they work, right? Now, if you imagine yourself to be a developer, you build condos, right? You buy a piece of land, you build condos, 500 units, you want to sell to investors, to home buyers, right? Obviously, on one hand, you have to manage your costs, right? On the other hand, you have to think of how much you want to sell. You cannot sell too high. Yes, you make more profit, but nobody's going to buy from you. You sell too low, you don't make enough money to cover your costs, right? So the thing is that, how do developers think in terms of their pricing strategy, right? Again, it's a very big topic, but I will just tell you very specifically, share with you very specifically, the answer to this question, whether developers are likely to sell you a property that can be undervalued or not, right? Now, the thing is, if you are the boss of CapitaLand, right, you build ABC condo, and ABC condo is not selling well, for example, not selling well, right? Maybe the investors don't like certain things, right? Not selling well. So you have already started construction, you can't change already, right? The only thing is you can adjust your price, right? But I can tell you the price, to cut their price from this level to this level, is the last thing is on their mind. I can tell you why. Because you drop the price straight away, your profit gets affected straight away, right? So instead of dropping the price, what is the one most common thing developers like to do? I can tell you, I can guarantee, right? It will work for any projects, any new launch they are selling. Right?
More commission.
You want to see the answer? You want to see the answer?
If
the answer is something which I think most of you will not have expected. Right? It's not dropping price, it's not giving discount, it's not coming up with star buy unit or all kinds of fanciful things. Right? They just need to do one thing. And the answer is this. The answer is this.
Give more commission.
Correct, right. So, as you know, developers, they work with marketing agents, right? Marketing agents means the big companies like Huttons, Promnex, ERA, Orange Tea, those kind, right? So, the marketing agents are the one who have a lot of agents and go out there to sell the properties to you guys, right? So, the thing is, if I'm the boss of CapitaLand, right, I see that, oh, my ABC condo is not moving, then how, right? The first thing on my mind is not to decrease price. Because when I decrease price, next time very hard to increase already, you know? Right? Because when I decrease price, a lot of people buy already. I want to increase. Then those people who are coming in later and say, hey, last time you sell, you know, $200 cheaper, now why like that? Right? So it actually affects myself. Right? So the thing is, I will not decrease price. But what I will do is, I will pay more commission to the agents to help me sell. So maybe I pay the agents maybe 2%. Commission for one unit, right? So what I'll do now is I increase to 3%, right? Or 4%, right? I can tell you, I've seen so many cases. I won't want to name the projects, right? I won't want to name the projects, but I share with you very honestly, right? Projects which are paying like 1% to 1.5%, those kind of rates are hardly move, right? Then after a while, the developer realized something is wrong. I got 1,000 over units, cannot sell their power, right? At the 5 years deadline to meet before I get penalized to pay the ABSD. Then what they do is suddenly raise the commission, right, to 4%. Wow, I can tell you, magically, you see all the agents all go and sell their property project. Even though, in my opinion, those projects I also don't know why people want to buy, to be honest. I look at the price, look at the everything else, I see this kind of price, I don't see any value, right? I don't know why people want to buy. But every week is like, what is a top selling project? Every week, every month, top selling project. I also don't know why, right? So I think of it, or maybe, 4% commission, of course, the agents will sell, right? So this is the magic, right? Developers only deal with marketing agents. They don't deal with you. If today you got a complaint, you say, you know why my property is like that? I bought, I bought ABC condo from CapitaLand, right? You cannot go to CapitaLand, bring their hotline, and bang their table and say why this, why that. You cannot, right? You cannot. They won't entertain you. Why? Because they'll tell you, go and talk to your agent or my marketing agent. You buy from who? Or a Promnex agent, ERA agent, or you can find them. Right? You can find the person in charge there. They will tell you this. So developers only deal with agents, right? They won't deal with you. Then the agents, right? On top, they deal with developers. Then who they sell to? Sell to you. Sell to you. So if my boss on top, my developer pay me high commission, does it motivate you? Does it motivate them? Right, you ask yourself. Right. Now look at your own situation. If let's say you are employed, today you are employed, you're earning 10,000 a month, you're doing this job scope, right? If let's say a competitor come to you and say, hey, so and so, right, okay, I pay you 12,000 a month, 13,000 a month, doing almost the same job scope, will you resign and move to the next company? Everything is money, I can tell you, right? Money will work wonders. Even if today your resale property cannot move, right? You pay your agent how much? Of course, cannot move like 1%, 2%. You're so stingy how to move, right? Not. You pay your agent 3%, 4%, you see whether move or not, right? Obviously, the thing is different, right? So they will pay the highest, high commission, increase the commission they pay to the agents. Magically, their units will move, right? I've seen so many examples. I wouldn't name them, right? In the last few years, right, projects magically fly off the shelf. Even though I look at the project, I don't know why people will buy. I can tell you, right. But this is not a session to name the projects. I won't say anything. Right?
Okay,
this is just something which a strategy that they will do. Okay, you must understand they will do. Right.
Let's move on, Colin. Let's move on before we start. Accidentally naming the projects. Let's move on.
Yeah, I move on. Right. Okay. So, So they will not discount price, but they will pay more commission to the agents, right? Now, the second thing is, if they are really desperate, right, they can come up with a lot of creative financing schemes, right, like deferred payment schemes and all those things, right, that will, again, move a lot of their projects, a lot of their units, right? What these are really applicable for those that have already completed, because deferred payment scheme can only be applied for those completed projects, right? Building under construction projects cannot have this kind of, you know, creative financing schemes, right? And a lot of these kind of schemes are actually happening in District 9, 10, 11, those high-end ones, a few million dollars, like sitting there, nobody buy, right? So developers will do something like this kind of thing, they offer deferred payment, right? One good example last year, 2019, was this landed property called Luxus Hill, right? Luxus Hill is in Ang Mo Kio, right? Over one weekend, the developer sold about almost 70 units, right? 70 units, Luxus Hill, right? And each unit is about $3 to $4 million. You're not talking about, you know, $1-2 million property. Each unit is $3 to $4 million, right? And over one weekend, which is Saturday, Sunday, almost everything all gone. Only left 1-2 units only, right? So the thing is, why is it like this? Right? It's because it's completed already. Developers can give you deferred payment, a lot of flexibility, right? For those people who have a loan issue, ABSD issue, then they can tap on this, right? Magically, the units will fly off the shelf. And again, developers are not cutting their price, right? They are still selling at $3 to $4 million for Luxus Hill. They didn't sell at $2 million, right? Okay, but it can still sell because of all these schemes that they have, right? And two other developers have two other strategies that they can use, but I won't go into those because it will be too lengthy already. But these are the strategies which I shared during my program. It's over one weekend, two full days. Last time I used to do 3 days, right? But I won't share this here, right? Okay, I'll just leave it as that, right? So the question here is really, developers really do not need to slash their price, even with pandemic or whatever, right? In order for you to buy the properties from them. Right, okay, you must understand the best thing they can do to move their properties, move their units, are really point number one, right? To incentivize the agents, right, to sell, help them sell more properties, right? That's the most direct incentive, right, for the salespeople to go and sell, right? So now coming back to this whole thing, right? If you can't, if you can't buy an undervalued property from the resale market, and also if you can't buy an undervalued property from a developer, then where do you find undervalued property? Where is this $300,000 going to come from? Right. Yes. Now, the answer is this, right? I think in order for you to have this, you know, make this money, make this like $300,000, right, okay? You need to change your thinking. A lot of people need to change their thinking, right? What do I mean by change their thinking, right? Now, you see, a lot of people want this thing. They want this. So, for example, a $1 million property, okay? They want to buy like this. They want to buy like this. They want to buy at $800,000. They hope to be able to buy at $800,000, right? So they're very happy. Wow, I straight away get $200,000 below market value, right? So this kind of situation, whether is it in the resale market or the new launch market, I ask you where to find. You find for me. Really, you find for me. If I know, I can tell you, if I know such property, right, I will buy myself first. I won't even share with you, right? Even if I have no money to buy, I ask some friends, come, right? This one like that, right? Really undervalued so much, right? We come, each one put some money together, we buy this, after a few years, we sell, we show me money, right? Why I want to share with you? Correct, I'm telling you all these things very truthfully, right? If there's such a good deal in the market, right, you're looking around, unless you find yourself, right? If you ask friends and all these things, agents, honestly, it is so good, they buy themselves first already, right? The thing is, I still receive a lot of inquiries every day on the phone, right? At least a few, right? People, you know, ask me all sorts of property questions, right? And this is one kind of questions which people like to ask or tell me, right? You know what they tell me? After we almost finish the conversation, I know what this person is looking at. Then he will tell me, he may like, by the way, just tell me this, tell me this thing, right? He will say, if you come across a good value property, bank sale, fire sale, whatever sale, right, cheap sale, you let me know. I will just like, oh, and I put it on the phone, right? this is the thing I tell you, you people need to change your thinking, right? If it's really such a good deal, I tell you, really, why should I tell you, right? Why should I go and tell you? I can make money myself, I go and tell you for what, right? Unless you go and find yourself, right? So this is the thing that I can tell you honestly, right? People who ask this kind of question, sometimes I really hope they can change their thinking. So a lot of people want this, right? $1 million property, they hope to be able to buy for like, wow, 20, 30% below market value, which is not going to happen. You're going to find me one, right? You're going to find me. Even just now, you know, just now, my example, my student, right? Only bought for like one, only less than 10% below market value, only about, maybe about 5 to 7% below, right? Okay, it's not, it's $1.1 million property he bought like about 980K, is about, I don't know how much is that, right? It's not like this kind of numbers, right? So this kind of numbers is too ridiculous already, right? That is almost impossible for you to find, right? So now if you can't find directly outright this kind of 20%, 30% below market, undervalued by so much kind of properties, then what must you do? The thing is that there are still such properties in the market that you can target, right? But you need to change your thinking, right? Don't ask me question like, oh, today you got undervalued property by 50%, 30%, you can't tell me, I won't tell you what, because I don't know where to find this property. You can find yourself. Right. I will tell you to change your thinking. What is the thinking that you should adopt? You want this, but you need to accept this. And what is this? Right. If the property market value is 1 million, right, which is what most sellers are selling you, right, based on market value, 1 million. They're not going a lot below market value. Right. So based on $1 million property, sellers in the resale market are selling also about 1 million, right? Developers also sell you about this kind of price, right? So if the property, whether it's from a resale market or new launch market, is $1 million, right? It's okay. You can buy from them. You can buy from them at $1 million, right? You don't expect to sell at, sorry, you don't expect to buy at $800,000 or $700,000. It is okay if you buy at $1 million from them at market value from the resale person or the developer. It's okay to buy it, right? But provided, right, you'll be very careful. What do I mean by very careful? Means you must ascertain, you must be very confident that this property you're going to buy $1 million can give you that potential capital appreciation to $1.2 million, right? You must be confident. And the $1.2 million must happen within the next 5 years. At most, next 5 years must happen, right? I'm not talking about 20 years. You talk about 20 years, honestly, all the properties in Singapore also will go up due to inflation, due to price increase or whatever, right? Okay, so we're not talking about what, 10, 20 years go up a little bit, right? Of course, will happen, right? But we're talking about, you know, making money, creating the most wealth in the shortest period of time. We're talking about that, right? Shortest period of time while minimizing your risk. That's always where I'm coming from, right? So the thing is, you can still buy properties at $1 million, whether from the resale market or from the new launch market. It's okay, provided you are super sure, right? You're damn sure that, right, your properties you're going to buy can appreciate that $200,000, $300,000, right, in the next 3 to 5 years, right? And that is the main message for tonight, really, right? Change the mindset. There's no such thing as undervalued property. You know, the concept of undervalued property is very appealing, very sexy, right? Everybody thinks, wow, I got a super good deal, wow, cheap deal, wow, I ripped off the seller, wow, so happy, you know, shook feeling. But I ask you one question. If you have a HDB or a condo today, right, you will know your HDB or condo price roughly how much is the value, right? I ask you one question. How many of you will fire sale your own HDB and condo today? Right. If you are going to do it, can you please type in? You type in, right, I see who I call you. Right. I call you, I find someone to buy from you. Right. If you see, if you are not yourself, not even willing to do it yourself, you expect some strangers out there to do it, then the common argument people will tell me is, oh, you know what, there's always a distress sale, distress seller, bank seller, bank chase them, mortgage sale, this kind of thing. Yes, I know, there are always this kind of thing, one, right? But the question is, I said already, there's a valuation price, right, okay, right. Even if it's not sold through an auction, sold through a bank, right, okay, the seller want to sell, right, the seller also won't be so stupid until lower, until like this kind of example, 1 million sell you 800,000, right. Even if 1 million sell you maybe 950 or 930, that is maybe more reasonable. You can hope for those, right. A 5%, 7% max below the average value, I think that's still reasonable. but not like, you know, a few hundred thousand off. That is a bit too far off already. Right? So the thing is, we really need to, it's okay, right? It's okay to go for properties which are market value, right? But you aim for those that give you very good appreciation potential, right? And again, today, if let's say, for example, if you look at what are the properties which can give you that capital appreciation potential, right? Okay, maybe I show you a few examples, right, of real properties in the market, right? And you'll get a hint of probably where you should be looking, right? Now, the thing is, at the beginning of this video, I shared that I like to use the year 2013, right? Because 2013 is the year that the property market starts to stabilize, right? So I always like to reference back to the year, maybe not 2013, maybe 2014, okay, 2014, right? Because why? Because the thing is, if I go, let's say I want to study the market, right? I go back to the year 2010, a 10-year history, right? 2010 to today, right? 10-year history. I study a resale property bought in the year 2010 versus a new launch property bought in 2010, right? I will come to the conclusion that, oh, both resale and new launch also make money. Why? Because the property market was still going up. 2010 was going up. 2011 was going up. 2012 was going up. 2013 was still going up, right? So it will make money. Then how can I, you know whether a new or property, new or resale property is better, right? I won't know. But if I use the correct reference point, right, 2014 until today, I can see something very clearly, right? Now, I'm going to show you some examples here, right? For example, you see this, this is my favorite, right, Sims Urban Oasis. I asked a lot of my students to buy this in 2015, right, okay? At the point of time when Wokoland launched this project, it was about 1,003 to 1,004 PSF. As you can see, we are just comparing one bedroom here, right? One bedroom, the contract, you can see that they are all done in the March, first half of 2015, right? So you can see the pricing of the PSF is all about 1.3 to 1.4, in general, 1.3 to 1.4, right? So this is a new project bought in 2015. So today in the resale market, right, the same one bedroom is selling for about 1.6 to 1.7, right? 1.6 to 1.7, right? What does it mean? The price has gone up by about $200 to $300 per square feet. Right. So if you look at, I go to the previous slide, right? You look at it in terms of absolute quantum, right? Absolute quantum. Most of these projects you can see starts with about 500,000 to 600,000, right? Between 500,000 plus to 600,000 plus, right? At the time of purchase back in 2015. But today, those people who bought this property, today they're selling for easily above 700,000. Means what? Means they have made at least about 100,000, 100 over 1,000, right? Okay. So let me see if there's any example. Okay, you see this unit, the second one. Colin, can you see my pointer?
Yes, I can.
Okay, you see my mouse pointer, the second property, 0206, right? Second floor, you know, second floor, right? He paid how much? He bought at 603,000 back in 2015, right? So 2019, he sold, you see this one? Right, this one, the fourth from the bottom. 0206, he sold June 2019 for 735,000. What price did he buy? 603,000. He sold at 735,000. How much did he make? 130,000. In just how many years? 4 years, right? Did he do anything? Nothing, right? Because 2015, what did he do? He just go and buy the property. Right, 2015, he bought the property, pay the bank, you know, pay the deposit and all those things, took a loan, and then the rest of the time, most of it is under construction. So he thought, this buyer just sit down there and shake leg, do nothing, wait until collection, key collection, take the key already, then what does he do? Maybe he rent out or he sell, right? And he sold for 735,000, right? And he make 130,000, just like that, doing nothing, almost nothing, but just waiting. Waiting can also make so much money, right or not? And this is not even a top floor, high floor unit, no? 0206 is the second floor. I don't even know what's the facing. Maybe face a rubbish bin, right? Even a unit potentially face on the second floor, low floor, may potentially face a rubbish bin or the main entrance, also can make use 130,000 in just like 4 years, okay? That is for Sims Urban Oasis. The next new launch I show you is this High Park Residences in Sengkang area. So this project was launched also in 2015. And the big joke is that you can buy a condo for less than the price of HDB, which is true. You look at the price here, right? Price only about 400,000. Can I even buy a 5-room HDB in Bishan? Right, okay. So the thing is, wow, extremely cheap. 400, a lot of them, okay, you look at the size, the size is smaller, 388 square feet, right? But the general price is about 1,000 PSF. So that's why the entry price for this property back then, 5 years ago, was about less than 400K. So if you tell me, wow, you know, Sengkang cannot buy, too ulu, every day go and eat prata only, nothing over there, all bush and nothing else, right, okay? This kind of property, how can buy? This time sell to who, right? You'll be surprised. Okay, before I show you how much they sold, right, okay? Now think of it, back then, during 2015, your financing quantum is 80%. So the thing is, 80%, so means you come up with 20% down payment. So let's say this property 400,000. 20% is how much? It's about 80,000. 80,000, right? Okay, 80,000. So 80,000 plus a bit of stamp duty, maybe 100,000. So your initial capital to buy this, you know, this property at High Park, right, was about 100,000 back in 2015, okay. Right? 100,000, right? So the thing is, your capital 100,000. So recently, how much has it been sold? 2019, you can see the screen here, 2019, right? Okay. Most of them, same size, sold for about 500,000. 500,000, right? Means that if the person bought from, can you see, 380K, bought 380K, 380K, now he sold 500K, 500K, can see or not? Right. The difference is how much? 120,000. I should have a whiteboard. Next time, do a whiteboard better. Right. 120,000. Why not? 120,000. Right. 120,000. How much did this person put in 5 years ago or 4 years ago? Only 100,000. Right. He put in 100,000. Same thing. He did nothing. Pay a deposit. Took a bank loan. Sit down there. Shake his leg. Do nothing for most of the time. Collect key. Ran out and managed to sell his property. Right. So he sold for 500,000. So don't look at this 500,000 so small, little kacang putih money. But if you are the investor, you make a lot of money, you know. You only put in 100,000 in 2015. Today, you sold the property, you get back your entire 100,000 plus another additional 120,000, right? Just by doing nothing, just because this property went up in price, right? So if you extrapolate, right, okay, new properties, well, can give you 100 to 200,000 within a few years. Is it reasonable to expect a new property to give you 300,000? Right. Reasonable. Right. There are one or two properties in the last few years which did that. Okay. But I don't have the examples here. Okay. But maybe the next time I will show you. Right. Okay? Yeah. But there are such properties. Right. Now, so that is for the new launch market. Right. As you can see, the appreciation actually went up quite significantly for certain properties. Then what about the resale market? You want to buy from a resale market. Right. Resale market, if you look at this estuary in Yishun, right? Here's a resale property, not too old, about 10 years old, right? So if let's say you are thinking of buying a 3-bedroom for home stay, you bought this in 2015 at about 1,003 square feet is about 1,000 PSF, right? So up till last year or this year, how much are you looking to sell, right? You can see the bottom table, okay? The price is still the same. Right, it's about 1,000 PSF. Okay. In fact, let me see. There's one example here. Right. You look at the top one, 0631. Okay, 0631. Right. So this person bought a few years ago at about 1.25 million. Right. So he sold at the bottom, the last line here, he sold last year at about 1.3 million. So he made 50,000. Which is not too bad. I mean, 50,000 appreciation, right? Okay. So the thing is that a lot of properties, the prices, if you look at the two red boxes, you compare, is actually about that in the last few years, right? That means to say that a lot of resale properties, actually the prices hardly go up, right? So this is for estuary. And I give you one last example. This is in Simei, okay? A resale condo in Simei, double bay residences. So this one, let's say you're looking at about 1,001 PSF, okay, back in 2014, 2015, 1,001 PSF, right? So today is about 1,001 PSF, okay? The price didn't really go up, okay? okay, didn't really go up, right? Still about 1,001 PSL, 1.3 million, still about 1.3 million. Right? So that is the thing that when I saw this, and these are not just the two properties I've seen, you know, I mean, these are just two examples just to illustrate my point. But really, the thing is that I've seen like easily like over 200 resale properties in the market. I just randomly choose a few and test, right? One bedroom also test, three bedroom also test, right? A lot of the resale properties that are bought, right, from the year 2014 until today, right, hardly show any price appreciation, right? Whereas a lot of new projects bought 2014 until today are something similar to the kind of like Sims Urban Oasis and the kind of Hyde Park residences story. That the irony is this, that a lot of people think that, you know, resale market, the PSF is lower, for the same quantum, they can get a bigger unit, right? When you think of new projects, you always think that, oh, the PSF is higher so that you need to pay more and, you know, the rooms are very small and all these things, right? But surprisingly, what you are seeing here, just two examples here, right? Two from the resale market, two from the new launch market. What we are seeing is counterintuitive that, you know, even though a lower PSF, you have bought this lower PSF a resale property, right? You think that lower PSF means higher chance of making money, right? Higher PSF means it's like almost at the top, maybe cannot go up already. But the chances, what evidence are showing us is that those higher PSF properties, those newer properties are actually go up, still continue to go up, whereas those lower ones are stuck there, right? So the interesting question which you have to ask yourself, or I have to ask myself, is why are we seeing this, right? You are seeing this phenomena where it is counterintuitive, right? It's not the kind of thing you can easily accept and understand. Why is it that resale properties are not going up and new ones are going up, right? And the conclusion I come after analyzing and after thinking is this. This is the conclusion which I'm going to share with you, right? Is that if you had bought these double bay residences in 2015, right? Chances are you paid 1,001 PSF, right? But don't forget, this was launched in 2008. And maybe those people back then bought at 700, 600 PSF, right? When the price was lower, right? So you buy in 2015, right, at 1,001 PSF, right? Over the last 5 years until today, the price didn't go up. Why? Because simply it's because you are being sabotaged by all your other neighbors who bought earlier than you and at a cheaper price than you. So if your neighbors have bought at 600, 700, 800 PSF, right? Even today, the last 5 years, they want to sell, they can easily continue to sell 1,001 plus, around this kind of price. They still make that few hundred dollars PSF in terms of capital appreciation. But you are stuck, you are dead. Your price is not going up because all these transacted price you see here, right, form the basis of, you know, buyer seller's perception and the bank valuation, right? Your price is not going up because if today you want to sell double bay, you have a unit at double bay, you want to sell 1,003 PSF, who's going to buy from you? Nobody's going to buy from you, right? You want to make that $200, nobody's going to buy from you. Why? Because the buyer who come and see your place, 1,003, right? Okay, thank you very much. I'll buy your neighbor 1,001 only, right? Or 1,000 only, right? So end up, you stuck there for a long, 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 long time, right? Whereas for examples like this kind, right? Hyde Park this kind, or maybe like Sims Urban Oasis, right? Or Hyde Park this kind. You bought in 2015, right? 1,000 over units here, right? All the owners all buy at the same price, 1,000 PSF, right? So upon key collection, the simple reason is that, you know, everybody collected keys, right? Everybody bought at the same price, about 1,000 PSF, right? And some of them want to sell, some of them want to buy, sorry, some of them want to sell, some want to rent out, some want to stay, right? So I don't care what your decision is, right? The thing is that, usually within about 2 to 3 years upon TOP, you'll start to see some resale movement already. And the thing is that logically, every owner in high park residences, they bought at 1,000, right? They will want to sell higher, like this kind of price, 1,003, right? Of course, they want to sell 1,005, 1,006. Of course, they want to sell as high as possible, but the question is there such a market, right? So the 1,003 that you see here is the agreed price based on the buyers, what buyers are willing to pay, plus what seller is willing to let go. So that's why you see a few of these transactions at 1,003 PSF, right? And the good news is for all the people who bought Hyde Park, that helps the valuation because now Hyde Park has gone up to 1,003. There's no way Hyde Park is going to go back down to 1,000. No way. So if today you go and buy Hyde Park, right? I said you better don't buy Hyde Park, right? Again, I can tell you very honestly. Sometimes, again, people call me over the phone and tell me certain properties requirement. Oh, I only want new one. Okay, fine. Then I help you look for new one. Oh, I want resale. Or I help you look for resale. Some people tell me this kind of thing. I want a new one or resale that is not too old. When I hear this, what do you mean by resale that's not too old? Or means you are looking at properties like Hyde Park, this kind, maybe 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old, 6 years old, this kind, right? So I'm thinking, wow, why you want to buy resale that's not too old? You buy resale not too old, also the same as resale old, I tell you, right? Because why? The first owner who bought from developer already make money and sell to you already, like Hyde Park today, will you dare to go and buy Hyde Park 1003? If you dare to buy Hyde Park 1003, I say, good luck to you. I don't know when you can make money, I can tell you, right? You stuck there for next 10 years, I can guarantee you, right? Why am I so confident? It's because all the owners, all the thousand over owners, all back bought at what kind of price? 900 plus 1,000, right? Today, you buy 1,003 from a resale person at Hyde Park, right? Are you shooting yourself, right? You better take the money and buy something else, right? So whether old resale or new resale actually is the same old thing, right? The thing is that the person who bought from the developer already take the money, zao already, right? You are left hanging on to that thing which cannot make money, right? So, okay, let me forward this, right? Now, this is really the part where, the explanation why resale properties are hardly moving, whether old or new, right? Whereas new launches or new projects in the last few years, we have seen that, quite counterintuitive, they can actually move up higher, right? Move up higher. So, what's the time now? What? 10:35 already.
More than one hour already.
Yeah. Wow, more than 1 hour. So you can talk until a few slides, 1 hour already. Right. So the thing is, I think actually I prepared already, right? I prepared. That means to say that tonight's session, I cannot finish in one session, right? Unless I want to talk for 3 hours. Right. So what I've done is actually this is my last slide. Right. This is my last slide. I will stop around here, right? And I'll leave my explanation, further explanation to next week. Same day, same time, Wednesday, 9:30 PM. Right. So basically, what I've done in the last 1 hour is to really share with you guys, property investors or home buyers, that if today you are going to buy a property, definitely you need to buy from somebody, right? Whether is it from a resale person or developer, right? And I've shared with you that if you buy from a resale person, chances are they are not likely to give you a big discount or fire sale their properties, right? The reasons why I've shared with you, right? Developers, same thing. Right, it's unlikely that they will sell to you at a very cheap price. So the thing is that if you are not able to buy a so-called really undervalued property from either the resale market or the new launch market, right, then your thinking need to change. But unless you don't want to invest in property, otherwise you need to change your thinking. Right, that okay, I cannot straight away go out there and rip somebody off $300,000. Right, then I must change the thinking that property is still good, long-term investment is still okay, right? But I need to change my thinking. My thinking must be, I can select properties which can give me very high capital appreciation potential. That means to say that in the next 3 to 5 years, I can have like successful stories like Hyde Park or Sims Urban Oasis or whatever, right? That makes me like 100,000, 200,000, even 300,000, right? I see that do nothing, right? That is the kind of things we are going after, right? So today is really to really correct people's mindset that don't think so much of hoping that you can go to a seller or developer and say that you want 10% discount, 20% discount. It's unlikely to happen, right? But what you can do is condition your mindset to look for properties not undervalued, right? Okay, but with good value, buying with good value and good capital appreciation potential. That is the most important thing. So exactly what properties are these? Maybe I will talk about it in the next session. Next session, I will basically, right, hey, Colin, go, Ivan, maybe I still got my last screen.
Oh,
last screen.
Okay, let me maybe, help sum up a little bit first at this point of time, it's incredible that we still have more than 60 people, watching down here. And the poll that I put up, I think a lot of them, easily 96% of people really want to find out which are these so-called undervalued projects that we are talking about. So maybe, very quickly, I do a recap of what Colin E has mentioned. you know, as an investor, as a friend, you know, I'm not a property agent. So I'm going to share from my point of view what has he talked about. Okay, so essentially, you know, what Colin is saying that this year, I think we can forget about fire sale, you know, maybe even ever. What is happening down here is that I think sellers by and large have holding powers. Okay, and MAS, you know, is really giving this opportunity for people to not service their loan for the next 6 months. You know, if someone opted in since last month, 7 months of a loan relief period. Okay, so people won't really, you know, sellers won't really say that, hey, you know, let me just, I'm desperate, I will just put up my property for sale, you know, at 30% discount. It won't happen, all right? Also, you know, Colin was also talking about people over the years are having, you know, more and more savings in their banks. And really, auction sales closes are still at very low, 1.something%, you know, not over 2%. And lastly, even if all the four conditions happen, right, the government still have a couple of trump cards in their hands. Cooling measures still exist. We have 6 or 7 big cooling measures down there. What is happening is really, even if price, you know, continue to go or come down, whatever, the government can release one of the cooling measures. And guess what happens? Singaporeans being Singaporeans, once one cooling measure is given away, is lifted, right? People are going to go in again. Okay, so don't have high hopes. Don't even think about, you know, fire sale this year. Now, is it easy to find a undervalued property in the resale market? The answer is not really. Okay, so perhaps there might be one or two down there. But what we are saying down here is, chances are, by the time you spot them, it is already sold. Okay, agents by themselves, they are also good hunters when it comes to undervalued property. If they see the chance, why would they want to share with you? They would have taken it already. And don't forgetting, there are a lot of property investors out there who are doing exactly the same thing like you. And so they will be trawling for all this undervalued property. So don't really think about, you know, someone really sharing some deals like that with you. Now, if you look at new launches, developers, will they want to slash the price? Guess not, because Colin has mentioned that there are many, many measures that the developers can put out. For example, giving higher comm to agents. And because of higher comm, agents are more motivated to sell those units. So don't really think about getting a very, very good deal from the developer direct. So really, does it mean that we can't find, you know, undervalued property, 300,000 anymore? Now, if we shift our thinking, okay, that we are looking for something that is 30% discount to something that I buy at this price, there is a very good potential that I can get 30% increase capital appreciation down here, okay? Then I think it is possible to find this so-called undervalued property. It's all a matter of reframing your mind. It is a form of looking at the time frame. We cannot look things in retrospect. We must look at things into the future. So what is happening down here, you know, ladies and gentlemen, you know, thank you so much for staying with us for so long, you know, for more than an hour now. We didn't really expect, you know, to do this for more than an hour. We really don't have time to continue, you know, to talk about all these things. And I put out a poll to ask, if you want to know, you know, specifically what are these undervalued projects, I think overwhelmingly people love to see that, or love to find out that. Next week, we'll be doing something like that. Maybe I'll let Colin, you know, end this thing, take another 1-2 minutes, show your last slide, you know, and after that, bring us through what we're going to expect next week, because really, I think we are out of time already. Colin?
It's okay. Thanks, Colin. Go. I think the last slide is not really necessary, right? But I will just maybe just summarize. Just conclude by saying that. So the last 1 hour I've shared with everyone that you really need to reframe your mind that if you are still interested to invest in properties and you still believe that properties are good long term investments, then don't have high hopes about buying something which is going to sell to you cheaply, right? Okay. But frame your mind to think in terms of what kind of value are you paying versus a what kind of value are you getting versus the price you're paying, right? So next week, I will really touch on certain properties which I think are better ones in the market. And I think it is a bit sensitive, lah, to be honest, lah, because this is not a webinar where I can control, right? I don't know who else is watching, right? And never mind, it's okay, right? For the, you know, for the benefit of everybody, I will share certain examples of properties which I think have good value, right? And I will also share examples, maybe one or two, of properties which I think maybe you shouldn't buy, right? And I will really put this down. I already named the property, right? Is this okay? I think from a neutral perspective, I think it's okay.
I tell you what, Colin. So, you know, for those of you who are watching, right, if you really want Colin E, you know, to name all these projects next week, you know, enter in the comments below, say yes, you know, so we know that he is supported, you know. This is going to be pretty sensitive topic, and I commend him for being so courageous to do this. Like I said, you know, if you want Colin E to name you, you know, all these projects, tell you exactly what you should be looking for, comment yes in the comments below, okay? Comment yes in the comments below.
Yeah, so I am actually quite selective in terms of the projects which I think you can buy, and just for numbers, like, just for the sake of like, referencing, right, that today there are easily about 100 new launches in the market. I can tell you, I would say maybe about five. I think are of, I'm confident that you can make that maybe 200,000. Right. I'm not saying that the rest of the 95 are no good. It's just that to me, I cannot see the value yet, right? Doesn't mean that they're no good. Maybe they can make you the money, but if I got better options, why should I choose something which I am not so comfortable with? That is where I'm coming from, right? So I'm not saying that the rest are no good, right? It's just that I feel more comfortable with the few that I think are better ones, right? That can make me that 200,000. Okay, yeah.
Okay.
So thanks very much, guys. I think most of you are still here. So, okay, I can see Wilson, Mahendra, Mr. Ling, Raymond, Raja, Lau Pei Ling, Kelvin, thanks very much. My brother, right, okay, Leslie Mo, Lin Yap, Peng Wee Chong. Oh, nice to have you on reverse again because I have not seen you for a long time. My old NUS friend, Asen, is watching, right, Jason and all the rest. Right. So thank you very much for staying with me for the last 1 hour, and thanks Colin Go for hosting this series. So next week 9:30, I will be sharing about, you know, certain projects which I think are good, and I'll only talk about those new projects because I think this session I've already cleared that if I'm someone who is going to look for value or can make me that kind of capital appreciation potential, I think in the last few years, new properties have shown the evidence that they can do it, right? They can potentially make it. So next week, I'll only talk about new projects and no more resale. Yeah. So thanks very much, guys. Colin Go, any more things? If not,
yeah, I think, you know, we have a few questions within the comments. I think, Colin, if you don't mind, you know, you can address them offline.
Okay.
We really don't have time for this already.
Sure.
So we tune in, you know, we expect you guys to tune in to the property market analysis at 9:30 next Wednesday. It's going to be our last episode. We'll see, you know, if there's a demand for more, then perhaps we can do this after the circuit breaker is lifted, and maybe, you know, even do this in person in a classroom setting or something like that, so that more people can get even more value. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Colin, though, sorry, before we end off, I just answer one question. Matthew Mahendra, you asked this question, will I be sharing about commercial industrial properties, right? I think you are looking at this because it can potentially save you the ABSD, right, compared to buying residential properties, right? I can share this, but not next week, right? Maybe subsequent Facebook Live sessions, right? I can share that. Yeah, my opinion on commercial industrial properties.
Yeah.
Okay, so thanks very much, everybody. Thanks for watching tonight. Thank you. Right, so I'll see you next week. Right. Good night.
Bye. Good night.
Bye. Have a nice week ahead. Bye.